Till now we have talked about iconic memory. Let us now move to the other form of sensory memory, that is echoic memory. In case of iconic memory, we discussed that the total amount of information that can be retained is little more, but in terms of duration, it had a relatively shorter period compared to echoic memory, because echoic memory can hold information up to 4 to 5 seconds. And furthermore, it can also store the sequence of at least 250 milliseconds or more. Now, recollect what we talked about in the previous lecture, and this has to do with the way we had talked about issues in case of sensation. We said that ear, especially the inner ear, which has the fluid filled in the cochlea, has the nerve endings, and because the ripples that are created, it takes little longer time to settle down. Therefore, by default, the amount of information that will be held at right at the level of the sensory modality will be little longer, because in the previous case, in the case of eyes, it was basically the cis to the trans configuration and back to the cis configuration, which was basically facilitating a storage of information, whereas in the case of echoic memory, it is the settling down of the ripples that is created in the cochlea. And therefore, we realize that in terms of the auditory impulse that we receive from the external world, the amount of information, even though it might be less compared to what we retain at the level of eyes, but in terms of duration, we have much more longer life compared to iconic memory for auditory information. But the problem is, because both of them have a very limited period of time, iconic memory for 1 to 2 seconds, echoic memory for at max 4 to 5 seconds. So, the chances are that if you have a stimulus of the same intensity that enters the ear, then there would be a masking. You remember, even in the case of iconic memory, we said that brightness and pattern masking are possible even at the level of the sensory modality. Similarly, here in the case of echoic memory, the sound masking can take place, and this becomes a barrier, because it will not allow you to listen to the what you call the purest form of the auditory impulse and retain it for a maximum of 5 seconds. Having discussed echoic and iconic memory, let us just make a comparison between the two. Iconic memory, in terms of duration, it is just 1 to 2 seconds, whereas echoic memory, in terms of duration, it is 4 to 5 seconds. So, the life of echoic memory is little longer compared to iconic memory, but the advantage in the case of iconic memory is that it can retain relatively longer amount of bit of information. So, approximately somewhere between 11 to 16 items can be held in terms of iconic retention. Echoic retention, the moment you have two sounds of equal intensity, masking will take place. Now, having talked about sensory memory, let us now go to the other form of memory, that is the short term storage, the short term memory. Now, in terms of life, short term has much longer life compared to the sensory memory. Iconic just 1 to 2 seconds, echoic just 4 to 5 seconds, but short term can store information for approximately 30 seconds. So, 20 to 30 seconds is the elastic time limit for which information can be stored in the short term memory. This would mean that after the end of 30th second, either the information which is at the level of the short term memory would trickle down, go to the long term storage, or it will be basically replaced, it will be flushed out by the incoming information. And we saw in the comprehensive model of memory that loss of information takes place from all the three channels. So, sensory memory, short term memory, long term memory, from everywhere we have loss of information, but in case of short term storage, either the information moves on to long term storage or the information is lost and replaced by the incoming information. What is also interesting about short term memory is that the information that comes to short term storage is encoded, okay, in acoustic format. So, speech, sound, visual images, words, they constitute, you know, the code that is retained by the short term memory. Okay. Because these are, you know, meaningful things, speech has its meaning, sounds might have meaning, visual images would represent something, okay, and words, it is again not nonsense syllables. So, because it is words, therefore, it would carry some meaning. Therefore, the information that comes to short term memory, it is largely semantic in nature, it is meaningful in nature. Okay. And because meaningful words, meaningful symbols, meaningful sounds allows you to process it in a different way compared to when you have nonsense syllables or you have things which are completely devoid of meaning. So, the moment you start elaborating it, okay, you remember the Craig and Lockhart's model, no? So, perceptual level of analysis, structural level of analysis, semantic level of analysis, all of them had a different impact on memory. So, if we go for meaningfulness, then by default you elaborate the information. Because you elaborate the information, therefore, semantic things, meaningful things will have a longer life compared to meaningless things. There are a whole lot of research in psychology comparing meaningful words with nonsense syllables. And there it has been uniformly realized that meaningful words, they have a stronger storage compared to the nonsense syllables. Okay. And this seems, you know, pretty obvious. Say for instance, if you are told rose, okay, it is much easier for you to have a mental image of rose and thereby remembrance of the word rose will be little longer compared to if I say XTPY, okay, which is nothing but four distinct alphabets that have been temporarily presented very neck to neck. Because it has been pronounced altogether, therefore, you might try your best to recollect it, okay, hold it for little longer, but then it is extremely difficult if such information, such set of nonsense syllables are presented to you in a sequence. What has further been realized in case of short term memory is that if you have a longer piece of information, then the possibility is that you might break it into smaller chunks. Now, think of a situation, you are given a number which is it has long chain of numerals. Okay. Let me show you this example and then we will come back to the discussion on chunking. Now, look at your screen. I am writing certain numbers. If I ask you to memorize this number and retain it at least for 30 seconds, because that is the duration of the short term memory. Now, if you start memorizing each of them, okay, you have a longer chain, no? So, you have total 14 digits here. Now, if you want to memorize it as 14 different set of information, okay, you are putting your short term storage in a big problem. Usually what has been realized that most of us either form chunks of 2 or 3 bits of information. So, those who would form chunks of 2 would do something like this, 65 46 51 15 19 31 31. Okay. Now, this 14 basically becomes 1 2 3 4 5 6 and 7. So, simple 7 chunks. Now, this is something that very easily your brain can store. you would realize that there are people who form chunks of three. So they would do something like this. So now you have 1, 2, 3, 4, and just 5 chunks. Life becomes much more simpler. Okay. So if I have to recollect the number, it becomes very easy for me. Why it becomes easy for me? Because I am now trying to memorize the number in terms of chunks. Okay. So I say 654, 651, okay, 151, 93, 131. It's much easier. You would realize that say for instance take when you have to recollect the mobile number, which is a 10 digit number in our country. If you have to memorize that number, how do we do that? Okay. And you would realize that even if you take your own example, perhaps you do not remember more than 3-4 mobile numbers. You remember mobile numbers of only those which matters to you. Parents, siblings, best friend, something like that. Now, what we do that if we have a longer set of information, we break it into pieces, and these smaller forms of information, which is either I said you can combine two of them or you can make a chunk of 3 bits of information. 4 bits, practically you will not find people using 4 bits. Okay. Now, things becomes much easier, and therefore, it has been realized that somewhere between 5 to 9 chunks can very easily be stored in short term storage. So, 9 chunks will primarily mean that 9 into 3 if you are making a chunk of 3. Okay. So, 27 bits of information you are basically able to store for approximately 30 seconds. Okay. Similarly, in children say that if the minimum span is going to be 5, okay, then 5 3 is 18. So, 18 bits of information a child can also store. And then in terms of say the number of items, now that we are extending that, say there could be possibility of forming chunks of 4, then you realize that approximately researchers show that 40 items can be stored, 40 discrete items broken into chunks, and accordingly the chunked information when you recollect it, when you store it, you realize that 40 distinct items can be stored right at the level of short term memory. So, if you compare iconic versus echoic, okay, the maximum that sensory memory could provide was at the level of iconic memory with 11 to 16 items. Here in short term memory, we go up to 40 items. No? So, there is a huge jump now, both in terms of pieces of information and also in terms of the temporal duration of the stay of information. Okay. Now, two things are very interesting in short term memory. Say for instance, if you are given a list, okay, a list which has say 20 names of people who can be your friends. You are told the list, you hear it, and then you are told to remember the nomenclature. Okay. Say for example, I say Ram Kumar Vishwakarma, Pradeep Kumar Sinha, okay, Arun Kumar Singh, Vishwanath Kumar Sharma. I keep on telling you names, or the way the psychologists have done in terms of their experimental work, that they have taken alphabets, okay, combination of meaningful and then nonsense syllables both, in increasing order of difficulty. For example, H, E, He, these are two alphabets, but He is a pronoun. Okay. S, H, E, She, okay. Three alphabets, but it has a meaning. Okay. So, the difficulty level has changed from two alphabets, He to She, three alphabets, then I say H, O, M, E, Home. Okay. So, 1, 2, 3, 4 alphabets. Okay. So, 2 alphabets, 3 alphabets, 4 alphabets. So, with increasing degree in the list, you also increase one alphabet. Therefore, this is called as a hierarchical difficulty level. Similarly, if I make nonsense syllables, I just put alphabets which has no meaning, X, T, two alphabets, and I compare, H, E, he versus X, T. The second alphabet was, the second word was she. Now, S, H, E, and I say X, T, P. The third word was home, which had four alphabets, and I say X, L, Z, P. It has been realized that whether you use meaningful words or you use nonsense syllables, two effects will interestingly come forward. And these effects combined, they are called as serial position effect. So, the position of the meaningful word or the nonsense syllable in the series, this is called serial position effect. And serial position effect will have two things, primacy effect and the recency effect. Primacy effect, the effect, the recall of the items which are presented in the primary stage, in the initial stage, that is the primacy effect. So, if I start with he, she, home, and go up to knowledge, government, statistics, the longer ones, then you realize that the words which are spoken in the beginning, they have a better recollection. Why they have a better recollection? Because you were mentally ready for the test. You knew that certain words will be presented to you and you will be asked to reproduce it. Then the words that come in the center, they have the adverse effect in terms of recollection. But then the words which came towards the end, before the test terminated and you were asked to recall the word, those words also have a better probability of being recalled, and that is called recency effect. Why? Because these were the items that you encountered most recently, and because it was encountered very, very recently, therefore, the chances of it being recollected is very high. Fine. So, primacy and recency effects, these two are very much dominantly found in short term storage. In the combined order, both these effects are called as serial position effect. Now, primacy effect is observed during delayed recall, because the initial items, they get time to be put in the long term during the presentation of the stimuli. So, there is a possibility that although we say that this is something that you find in the short term storage, there is a possibility that the information might trickle down to the long term storage as well. In terms of short term auditory memory, there are now evidence for two short term auditory storage, one which operates over a time scale of 150 to 350 milliseconds, and the second one which basically lasts somewhere between 2 to 20 seconds. So, again you find that even though it is more acoustic in nature, there could be a possibility that there could be two different auditory storage system that is working. But remember one thing, because we are on an introductory course, we are also on a brief introduction to this very course. Therefore, we will not venture into the details of all these things. There is also something called modality effect and recency effect. Recency we have already discussed, but in terms of auditory memory, there are also advantages to the spoken words. So, the modality that has been used for inducing the information, for sending the information to short term storage, and the nature of that very signal is something that also plays its role in terms of short term auditory memory. Now, what is very interesting in short term storage is that there could be a possibility of rehearsing the information. Why there is a possibility of rehearsal? Because the information has come, and unlike the sensory storage, you have the possibility of storing the information for approximately somewhere up to 30 seconds. Now, before you understand what rehearsal means and what are the two different types of rehearsal, understand this information by recollecting one of your past experiences. I am just trying to state a situation and you try to recollect something that you had experienced in the past. Say, you look at a telephone number in the directory, okay, 2597024, okay, that is the number that you read in the telephone directory, and then you start moving towards your drawing room where the handset is kept. The telephone directory was put somewhere else, the telephone handset is put somewhere else, and what you have to do is to remember this number till you dial it. So, what we do usually, we remember 2597024. What are we doing? Remember, we are chunking the information. So, 259 forms one chunk, 7024 forms the other chunk. Okay. And then once you come to that handset and you dial 2597024, the moment you have completed the dialing, you forget the number that you had tried to store for that period of time. Okay. You knew that the significance of this storage is only till you successfully dial the number. You were rehearsing the number, but what were you actually doing? You were rehearsing because you wanted to retain this information only till you could successfully dial it. This is called maintenance rehearsal. Okay. You are maintaining the information till the goal is achieved. The goal is to dial this number, that is it. Okay. The second set of rehearsal could be when you go for more and more of elaborative expansion of it. So, you receive the information and then you start elaborating it. So, while rehearsing it, you try to understand who this man is and what in what way is he related to my father. Why is it that my father has asked me to convey this to him over phone? Okay. His name is exactly the name of a neighbor of mine who happens to also to be a good friend of my father. You are now stretching that information. No? This rehearsal now is becoming elaborative in nature. Therefore, in short term, there is a possibility of a rehearsal which could either be maintenance oriented or it could be elaborative in nature. If it is elaborative in nature, we say it is elaborate rehearsal. If it is only for a given period of time, okay, then it is called maintenance rehearsal. And rehearsal plays an extremely important role in short term storage. Now, in maintenance rehearsal, the repetition of information is seen over and over again, okay, but it does not necessarily succeed transferring the information to long term memory. Okay. Whereas, in elaborative rehearsal, okay, there are chances that the information will be transferred to long term storage. Compared to maintenance rehearsal, in the case of elaborative rehearsal, the organization is done of the given material in terms of providing meaning to it while it is being rehearsed. So, you are rehearsing it, but you are also trying to give meaning to it. And therefore, because meaning is being assigned, therefore, it helps in fitting this very information with the information that already exists in our long term storage. Okay. Because the information is now put in a hierarchy, it is put in a meaningful order, therefore, it resembles to the pattern that suits the long term storage, and therefore, elaborative rehearsal is bound to push the information towards long term storage. Pushing information towards long storage would mean that the information will now be available to you even after the lapse of 30 seconds duration. The concept of chunk that we talked about, okay, 7 plus minus 2, 7 minus 2 will be 5 and 7 plus 2 will be 9. You remember in chunk we said that 5 to 9 chunks can be stored. So, this is basically the outcome of 7 plus minus 2. This is called the magic number, okay, because this allows the information to be ordered in the form of chunks, okay, and this chunk, a combination of it, can be stored with us for a relatively longer period. Okay. So, up to 30 seconds, maximum of 9 chunks, okay, and if you combine them together, then this helps us a lot in terms of arriving at a decision. Now, the size of the chunk varies greatly between experts and novices, no? Especially if you compare, say children, when they try to memorize number, the telephone number, the 10-digit mobile number, for instance, no? They usually do not show the tendency of making chunks of 3 or making chunks of 4, but gradually with little more experience, we all start doing that, even children start doing that. But even though we might have grown up, if you take adults who are not say chess players and compare chess master, you would realize that chess masters have much better memory and they use span of memory like anything, because they have to retain a series of moves. Okay. So, you need a very good storage system that helps you recollect what was the step that your opponents had taken, okay, in a series, and this will help you anticipate what could be the probable movement of your opponent if you make this type of a move. Okay. And again, studies show that experts can combine many memory units into a whole, okay, if they are master of that very field, compared to if somebody is a novice, if somebody is just a beginner. Another interesting concept that was introduced to short-term memory was the concept of working memory given by Alan Baddeley. Alan Baddeley's model talked about three things: articulatory loop, the visuospatial scratch pad, and the central executive. Alan Baddeley's model of working memory comprises of three things: central executive, articulatory loop, and visuospatial sketchpad. The central executive has a control over things and plays a role in decision making, reasoning, language comprehension, and transfer of information to long term memory are the tasks that it controls. Recency effect is also a function of the central executive. The central executive depends upon articulatory loop. It is also known as phonological loop. It is a short term buffer where verbal rehearsal takes place. The articulatory loop recycles items to facilitate immediate recall. The central executive also depends upon visuospatial sketchpad. It is also known as visuospatial scratchpad, as I told you, and it has to do with the rehearsal of visually presented information. This animation shows you the location of working memory in the brain. This is area 12 of the brain and is responsible for object related working memory. Close to it is area 47, which is responsible for face working memory, and this is area 46, and it is responsible for spatial working memory. Now, working memory basically consists of several subsystems of various types of tasks rather than single general capacity. Okay. And working memory in a specific skilled activity increases as one aspect of acquired skill. What is also very interesting to know is that the information, the chunks that we form, they are organized in a hierarchy in the short term memory. If you try to disorganize it, then storage becomes problematic. Okay. Now, you see your screen now. You see 0.25. The moment you go up, okay, you realize that the decimal place has changed. Now, it becomes 2.5. Okay. Now, you can use different strategies to memorize this information, but one interesting thing could be that you realize that the first number was 0.25, then you realize that this moved up and the decimal position changed. So, basically you remember only one set with repositioning of the decimal point, and then you say that this very information, this is how it moved. So, 2 moved to the third position, it became 2 into 2, this which was 4, and this 5 moved to the top, and this was repeated. Okay. Now, you just organize thing like that, and then you realize that remembering this information is not at all difficult. But if you do not organize information in the hierarchical order, recollecting it becomes very difficult, retaining it becomes difficult. No? So, whether it is elaborate rehearsal, whether it is maintenance, both will have problem. Maintenance of course, will have problem in because the numbers are not arranged in hierarchy, rather they are more randomized. Okay. If you go for elaboration, then elaboration by default will try to make it a little more meaningful and thereby try to arrange it in a hierarchy. So, with this we have completed our discussion on short term storage. When we meet next in our third lecture, we would be talking about long term memory.